The tension is palpable. The music is ominous and gripping. The scene is set, and the drama is about to unfold. Johann Sebastian Bach's Passion According to St. John is beginning to be revealed in a manner unparalleled. Hello, welcome to Bach Talk, and another in our series of conversations with Dr. A. Dennis Sparger, music director and conductor of the Bach Society of St. Louis. Today, a look at the storyline of the St. John Passion, including several clips from this amazing masterpiece. And Maestro, from the very start, those musical suspensions grab our emotions, and they won't let go.
Yeah, Ron, I couldn't agree more. It's a journey that we're embarking upon together. And like any journey, it requires preparation and commitment. The St. John Passion begins and ends with two large-scale pieces for chorus and orchestra, a prologue and an epilogue. And their function is to prepare you emotionally for what's about to happen, and at the end, to give you this final opportunity to take it all in and consider what this means to you.
And this wasn't intended originally as concert music, was it?
Well, no, not at all, Ron. Bach designed the Passion in two parts to surround the sermon on the Good Friday Vespers service. Although not designated by Bach, the two scenes can be divided into seven separate scenes, each telling an important part of the whole. The basic construction, then, is quite simple. Bach takes the story scene by scene, each beginning with a portion of the biblical narrative. Then he freezes the action and comments on what just happened. So, Ron, as we talked about last time, we hear the scriptures sung in recitative, then we reflect on what it means to us personally through an aria, or as a member of the congregation or audience through a familiar chorale.
And I don't think there's any question about it, but this opening chorus prepares us for the storyline in a very powerful way.
Yeah, it's amazing, really. As you said, the prologue really sets the stage for this emotionally charged drama. Now, the opening notes in the orchestra immediately capture the tension and turbulence. Listen for the constantly repeated notes in the basses. Then, at the same time, the repeated swirling figures in the violins. And then, finally, the overlapping dissonances in the woodwinds. Well, you get the idea. Now, if I were composing, I would give you one element at a time. But Bach delivers it all at the same time, and you have to sort it out or respond to it. Now, there's no question that Bach is a master in creating a mood of impending distress and doom. But when the chorus enters, it's not lamentation at all. It's Christ in majesty. Quoting Psalm 8, they sing, "Lord, our Master, how excellent is thy name in all the earth." So even as Christ faces his crucifixion, as underscored by the orchestra's turmoil, Bach simultaneously proclaims his glory and majesty.
The prologue is about 10 minutes long, and I realize we heard a little bit of it at the open, but I just think we have to hear a little more in order to hear exactly what you're talking about. So here is the Bach Society Orchestra and Chorus. Thank you. just a short portion of the prologue, the opening chorus to the St. John Passion by Johann Sebastian Bach. That was the Bach Society Chorus and Orchestra, conducted by Dennis Sparger. And with that, the curtain rises on this incredible story, and the scene is set for the betrayal and arrest of Jesus. And as you mentioned, Dennis, this all comes straight from the gospel narrative.
That's right. John chapter 18 is translated by Martin Luther and then sung by the evangelist. Now, returning to the betrayal and arrest. Following dinner, Jesus and his disciples go to a familiar garden. Judas arrives with an armed body of men, including Pharisees and the high priests. Jesus asks who they seek, and switching from recitative to a turbo chorus, the belligerent mob answers.
The Bach Society Chorus, joined by the very talented tenor William Watson, and I know you've mentioned this before, Dennis, but hearing it again, singing this evangelist's role certainly requires a unique skill set.
Oh, yes. Yeah, and Bill is just terrific. Very few tenors can deliver this difficult role. At this point in the Passion, the action freezes, and the chorus sings a familiar chorale. It's the first moment of its kind when the congregation of believers reflect on Christ's immense love and the price he must now pay for our redemption. After the soldiers bind Jesus and lead him away, the story stops again so we can ponder what has just happened. This time, it's not a chorale for corporate reflection, but a solo aria to encourage personal meditation. The alto soloist, or countertenor in our case, is joined by two oboes to lament, "To free me from the bond of my sins, my Savior is bound." During this aria, each individual is left to question, "What does it mean to me that Christ will take on my sins?" The second scene begins with Peter following Jesus to his interrogation. It doesn't take long before Peter is questioned and subsequently denies even knowing Jesus. Finally, Peter is standing by the fire, warming himself, and he is asked a final and third time, "Aren't you one of his disciples?"
"Bist du nicht? Are you not one of his disciples?" And instead of pleading the fifth, Peter denies the accusation.
And after the third denial, Peter hears the rooster crow. Remembering what Jesus had told him, he then went out and wailed bitterly. Listen to the heart-wrenching musical word painting that Bach provides for the evangelist at this moment.
William Watson, in the role of the evangelist, singing Bach's vivid depiction of Peter's lament over his denial.
And Ron, the tenor aria that follows reveals Peter's profound grief at what he has done. It's a heartfelt piece that reminds us that we, like Peter, have denied our Lord. Now, the entire aria can be heard in the brief recital that follows this talk. Part one of the St. John Passion closes with a chorale in which the congregation asks Jesus to touch my conscience whenever I do wrong. And in Leipzig, 1724, part one was followed by a one-hour sermon. Concert performances today will substitute a brief intermission.
Now, I notice you said part one rather than the first half of the Passion.
That's correct. It's actually about a third of the story. And part two begins, as part one ended, with a chorale. It's a powerful chorale at that, serving as another prologue, but also setting the tone for the rest of the Passion. Listen for how Bach uses chromatic harmony to intensify the graphic words in the final lines.
The powerful chorale that opens part two of the St. John Passion. And there are so many places where Bach demonstrates his knowledge of the whole of Scripture, and this is one of them, laughed at, scoffed at, spat upon. But it was as the Word predicted, that is, as the Old Testament had prophesied that events would unfold.
That's right. And as we talked about earlier, Bach knew his subject matter intimately. And the next passage is all about authority. Under the interrogation by Pilate, Jesus answers that his kingdom is not of this world. The chorale tune used so prominently in Bach's St. Matthew Passion, O Sacred Head Now Wounded, is also found here, but with a different text expressing our inability to repay Christ for his sacrifice. Pilate then declares he can find no fault in Jesus and asked the angry crowd, in accordance with the Passover custom, who should be released? You know their answer. Release a known murderer and convict Jesus. The recitative that follows describes in jagged accompaniment the painful scourging that was inflicted on Jesus by Pilate.
Und sprach,
ist dies nicht?
Barabbas, the murderer, is released. Jesus is brought to be flogged and whipped, and the moment is just gut-wrenching.
What follows this dramatic moment is a short, quiet aria filled with chromatic tension to describe the agony of the scourging of Christ. Then, the longest aria in the Passion directs us to focus on his back, now stained with blood. Both pieces are accompanied by lute and two muted violins, purposefully selected by Bach to create the most intimate moment, intended to speak directly to each individual's heart.
And you may recall hearing this during our mini-recital that followed talk number two. And based on what you've told us before, Dennis, this is a long aria for a purpose, because Bach wants us to really think about this.
Exactly. Scene four then opens with the soldiers placing a crown of thorns and purple robe on Jesus while the crowd mocks him. The music here intentionally sounds pompous and regal as the mob sarcastically hails the King of the Jews. But after Pilate returns and proclaims that he can find no fault in Jesus, the high priests and their servants shriek at him and shout, "Kreuzige," crucify him. Now, the driving rhythm of crucify, crucify, represents the unrelenting fury of the mob, and the extreme tension is highlighted by a series of overlapping dissonances.
The Bach Society Chorus and Orchestra, conducted by music director Dennis Sparger, in one of those intense moments in the St. John Passion, the moment when the angry mob shrieks, "Crucify him!" Well, Maestro, our time is up for today. I hope we can pick up the story right there next time.
Well, that would be great, Ron. We'll bring part two to its conclusion, but I hope we can also take a few minutes to talk about Bach's intention for this magnificent work and its inner theme.
Well, I'm all in. We'll plan on that. And I hope you will plan on joining us. With Bach Society Music Director Dennis Sparger, this is Ron Klemm, and this is Bach Talk.
Thank you for joining us for today's Bach Talk. This is part of the 2021 St. Louis Bach Festival, sponsored by Centene Charitable Foundation. I'd like to invite you to stay tuned for a special added attraction, a performance of two arias from the St. John Passion by two of our favorite soloists, each singer performing on location. Enjoy, and please join us again next time.
wo soll ich mich erquicken? Ach, wo soll ich mich erquicken? Ach, mein Sinn, wo willst du endlich hin? Ach, mein Sinn, wo willst du endlich hin? Ach, mein Sinn, wo willst du endlich hin? Wo willst du endlich hin? Ach, mein Sinn, wo willst du endlich hin? Wo soll ich mich erquicken? Wo willst du endlich hin? Wohin? Wo soll ich mich erquicken? Wo soll ich mich erquicken? Bleib ich hier? Oder wünsch ich mir Bett und Hügel auf den Rücken? Bleib ich hier? Bleib ich hier oder wünsch ich mir Bett und Hügel auf den Rücken? Bei der Welt ist gar kein Rat und im Herzen stehen die Scherzen. Meine Missetat, meine Missetat, meine Missetat, meine Missetat. Bei der Welt ist gar kein Rat und im Herzen stehen die Schmerzen. Meine Missetat, weil der Knecht den Herrn verleugnet hat, weil der Knecht den Herrn verleugnet hat.
Mein teurer Heiland, lass dich fragen, teurer Heiland, lass dich fragen, teurer Heiland, lass dich fragen. Da du nunmehr ans Kreuz geschlagen, und selbst gesagt, es ist vollbracht, bin ich vom Sterben frei gemacht. Bin ich vom Sterben frei gemacht, vom Sterben frei gemacht. Kann ich durch deine Pein und Sterben das Himmelreich ererben? Ist aller Welt Erlösung da, aller Welt Erlösung da. Du kannst vor Schmerzen zwar nicht sagen, zwar nicht sagen, doch neigest du da. das Haupt, doch neigest du das Haupt und sprichst, doch neigest du das Haupt und sprichst, stillschweigend. Ja, ja, doch neigest du das Haupt und sprichst, stillschweigend, ja, stillschweigend, stillschweigend, ja, doch neigest du das Haupt und sprichst, stillschweigend, ja.